As a folklorist who has spent the last 30 years studying the cultural traditions of my home state, I'm dedicated to documenting and presenting the cultural roots of Alabama. Ride along as I encounter Alabama's folk practices where they occur and meet the people who continue them. I'm Joey Brackner, and this is Journey Proud. Today we're driving through central Alabama in search of the disappearing Alabama grave shelter, which once was commonplace in rural cemeteries. We'll hear from experts and visit the people who maintain these enigmatic structures. Probably no one in Alabama has studied the cemetery landscape as much as Dr. Donald Gregory Jeane, known as Greg to his friends. Greg's work and his counsel have aided me in my own research of Alabama graveyard traditions. This morning, we're picking up Greg to visit some grave shelters, sometimes called grave sheds or grave houses, located in cemeteries in central Alabama, in the Coosa and Tallapoosa River valleys. I remember when I got out of grad school and moved back to Alabama, I came and visited you at Auburn University because I had read, as a grad student, your articles about the Upland South cemetery type, and you were one of the first people, if not the first person, who saw this complex of features. Mm-hmm. Will you tell me about that discovery, that documentation you did as a young scholar?
Yeah, the whole issue of getting started in this was an invitation by Fred Niffen to sit in on a doctoral seminar. And I was an undergraduate student at LSU. And in that kind of rambling discussion around the seminar table, he brought up the fact that cemeteries were under-researched as a cultural phenomenon, and went on to discuss why they are so important, probably the single most symbolic thing that humans do across culture, dealing with concepts of death and dying and symbolism. And then he launched into a description of these Upland South cemeteries. But when I went home, I sat down with my father and I said, "You're not going to believe what I heard," and went on about this guy from Michigan, this prof, talking about these cemeteries and described them. And I said, "I don't think he knows what he's talking about." You know, how you can be quite arrogant when you are really young and uninformed. But at any rate, I told my dad what he said, and he said, "Oh yeah, those are all over this country in Louisiana. I'm in west central Louisiana." And so I said, "Where?" And he said, "You take the road by your grandma's barn and you take it until it ends, and it's going to end at Cryer Cemetery." And so I immediately went, got in my car, and drove up there. And when I got out, my jaw just dropped. And here was this cemetery sitting on the top of this bluff, not a blade of grass in it, full of cedar trees, very few headstones. Most of them were field stones, mounded graves, shells all over them. And it was an epiphany.
Well, I guess Fred Niffen, K-N-I-F-F-E-N, uh-huh. I guess has to be considered the father of American cultural geography, wouldn't you say?
Yes, he was actually, from my understanding, he was the dean of American settlement geography. Anything related to, you know, the development of folk culture, the diffusion of that from origins overseas in most instances to the diffusion westward and through other parts of the United States from that eastern seashore core.
Well, so when we talk about grave shelters, this cemetery that you visited near where you grew up in Louisiana that your dad told you about, you were ground truthing what Dr. Niffin had told you. Did that have a grave shelter in it?
It did not have a grave shelter. Actually, I purely by accident came across a grave shelter later on, because then I started going to cemeteries all over western and central Louisiana, which was kind of my stomping ground at that time, and came across a small one in one of the cemeteries. And then I thought, wow, never seen anything like this. Where did this come from? And then I started asking around, and I'd find, you know, folks who'd lived their entire lives in these rural parishes. And they said, oh, you know, they used to be all over the place, and not very many left, and you need to go to such and such a cemetery because they've got one there and it's in bad shape. You want to make sure you go. And so that started that process.
What makes me so appreciative of cemetery committees like the one at Darien, the one at Eagle Creek, the one at Blue Springs that we're going to visit today, is that they have agreed to save at least the salvageable grave sheds.
Yeah.
In there, because just like having a denuded landscape in a cemetery,
yeah,
it's work.
Yeah.
And it requires an investment of money,
right,
and effort.
Yeah.
And so I'm so happy that we're going to be able to talk with some of these people about perhaps why they did it, how they're doing it, and in the case of Blue Springs, they're in the process of figuring out what it is that they need to do to save their grave shelters. So,
I vividly remember the first time that I went to Pruitt's Chapel Cemetery. A beautiful cemetery, classic Upland South cemetery, and it had either four or five grave shelters in it, and one of those was a child's. One day I told Karen, I said, you know, I'm going to drive up to Pruitt's Chapel and take some more pictures. Every time I go, I want to take pictures because it changes.
Yeah.
And I'll never forget driving up, and only one grave shelter was left. They had grassed it over. It had completely changed. If I were to show you those two, you would not notice the resemblance. It had changed so much.
Man.
And those are the kind of reminders of why it is so critically important to do exactly what we're doing today, and to talk to people who are trying to maintain that iconography, if it's the right word, or certainly iconic cultural traditions in material culture in their cemeteries, because they are going to change. And what happens is old dogs like us are going to eventually be gone, and you're going to get, you know, people say, you know, I'll come and mow it, but I'm not going to scrape, and I am not going to hoe weeds, and I'm not
going to replace the roof on that shelter.
You know, that we just tear that thing down. It's not worth the time and energy to rebuild it.
Well, one reason I want to do this show is to try to impress upon the people of Alabama, especially, and whoever else wants to see this show, is that we've got this chance to save an important cultural artifact.
Yeah.
A one that had deep meaning to those people who first erected them. And we should honor the memories of not only the people buried there, but the people who built those shelters and maintained them for all those generations. Yeah. And it'll be a teaching point about our heritage on the landscape.
I first visited Darien Cemetery in 2001 with the staff of the Alabama Historical Commission. The grave shelter and tombstone carving left a lasting impression on me. I was so happy when Wayne Cotney, Steve Welsh, and their families agreed to meet us at the graveyard. I commend y'all for keeping this grave shelter up. And I think Wayne told me it was your dad that has been that did a lot of work on this shelter. Can you talk about that?
Yes. The little grave shelter had got in foul repair. It was basically going to fall down. And my daddy kind of decided himself to do something about it and got some flack from some of the other people in the community because he did spend a good bit of money. And we haven't got a lot of money to keep our graveyard going as we'd like it. But he hired some folks to come in and help him and put a new top on it and got it back to where it's stable for the time being, and we hope to be able to watch, and when it gets unstable again, fix it again. That's our desire anyway.
Do either one of y'all remember there being other grave shelters in this cemetery, or is this the only one y'all remember?
It's the only one I remember.
Okay.
We're the same age, it's the only one I remember.
Okay.
Do we have any idea how old this is?
We're guessing.
Originally, or when you think it might have originally been built?
I'm sure that probably at least 100 years old, uh-huh. Because we're 70, and I remember as long as I can all the way back that it was here. But as far as exactly how long, I don't know that. I don't know that there's anybody living now that really would know. Yeah.
My experience is most of them are from 1880, 1875 to 80, up until about the 1930s, something like that from my work on them.
I agree with you on that. We know the church was started in 1842, and I'm thinking this was put out here fairly soon after the church was established and got growing, you know. Mm-hmm.
Well, we're going to take some pictures of this, and but before we do, tell us a little bit about this congregation. What kind of church is this, and what did the people in this community do?
Well, this was primarily a farming community, and this was Primitive Baptist, which they didn't, I guess at the time, didn't believe in musical instruments because we don't have one, and you know, and we sang Sacred Harp or Fossilized, most people know it, and a lot of people have never heard that, but that was the church, and usually the pastor that pastored here had two or three other churches, and it was one Sunday a month that you had church here, and then now, since we incorporated and got our committed together to keep the church and cemetery up, we have a couple of meetings a year to give folks a chance to come back home and feel like they're at home.
Mm-hmm. Well, I commend you and the others that help take care of this cemetery. It's beautiful. Y'all doing a good job. And thank you for saving this grave shelter because it's a great example and it's got a good roof on it. It's probably going to last a long time.
We thank you.
Thank you. And we're going to take a few pictures and then we're going to get down the road. And
thank you, sir.
I know y'all got something else to do. Like all Upland South cemeteries, Darien features eastward facing burials and once would have been completely swept free of grass. This graveyard not only has a grave shelter, but is full of the work of the famous 19th century stonecutter, William Rock Jackson. We're running late, but our route to Blue Springs takes us by Eagle Creek Cemetery, where there's an example of a double grave shelter. Greg and I stopped to take a few photographs before jumping back in the truck and heading on. Blue Springs Cemetery is the historic burial place for the Jaeger family and has two grave shelters that will be repaired by descendant Marty Jaeger. Art historian and grave shelter scholar Dr. Michael Panhorst has arranged to meet us and Marty's mother and aunts at the cemetery.
Michael.
Hey. How are you?
I'm good.
Good to see you, Johnny.
Have you met Greg Jeane?
Not yet.
Michael.
Mike Jeane.
Pleasure to meet you.
Nice to meet you.
And these lovely ladies.
Peggy Berryman.
Hey, Peggy.
And her lovely sisters.
Hey.
Hi, I'm Darnell.
I'm Joey Brackner.
Mm-hmm. Carol Yeager.
Hey, Carol. Nice to meet you. Michael, I see what you're talking about. These are beautiful shelters, and I notice, Peggy, this is a 1991 grave house, grave
yes.
shelter?
That's our aunt that's buried there, and her family, her two daughters had that built in either 91 or 92 for her grave.
And so what was going to happen to these grave shelters, or were y'all going to fix them up? Or?
Yes, this one is the one that we're more interested in preserving. Mm-hmm. This one is over our great-great-grandfather's grave.
My.
And it was built, the story goes, by our grandfather, who was his grandson.
Uh-huh.
And so he took care of it until he passed away, and then his older son did until he passed away. So now no one takes care of it. So till Marty found it, and so now Marty's very interested in restoring
it. Oh, good, good. So the baton is being passed
yes.
to the next generation. And Michael, I know you had told Marty you were willing to help him
yeah.
with something. What do you think needs to be done first to this old one?
Well, if you get around and look on the other side, you'll see that one quarter of it is sort of falling down.
Right.
And Marty's plan is to replace that piece of it at least. And he's shopping for materials, meaning old wood. This is constructed with square nails, and it's about as old as the church, probably 100 years or
yeah.
more.
Yeah.
And we can look at the dates on the burials there to get a good idea of the
right.
dates. There's also some roof damage that's not apparent from where you're standing right now, but
well, I'm going to go take some photos in a minute. And this newer one, are you going to try to, because I think it's very interesting that someone would build a grave shelter just, what, 30 years ago?
Yeah.
A little less,
mm-hmm.
yeah, about 30 years
mm-hmm.
ago, yeah.
I don't know. I'd have to talk to her daughters about
mm-hmm.
that. But yeah, they're very interested in keeping it.
Mm-hmm.
They come home once a year to check on it, make sure it's still in good shape.
Mm-hmm.
So they do that.
And I'd say it's holding up very, very well. And in fact, that's held up very well. And I think I mentioned to you not too long ago that I found a grave shelter that was built in 2010 up in North Alabama.
Yeah.
So this tradition, you know, continues this tradition of building grave shelters as well as maintaining them, showing respect to them.
Well, thanks for meeting us out here. You know, as we were riding up, Greg was saying to me, this actually has more of the elements of a traditional, what he has termed the Upland South Cemetery
yeah.
than any of the other ones we visited today,
right.
with the cedar tree, the old style church with the two front doors that are symmetrical in the front, and I'm sure at one time this was all bare earth and mounded graves.
Oh, it was.
Yeah.
My grandfather took care of it until he passed away.
Well, let's take a look around.
Yeah, I want to.
Don't let me run over you, Peggy.
Okay.
You see a date in there, Michael?
One death date is 1873, and the other is 1880-something.
Hmm.
1886, I think.
You see
that the
other side.
Uh-huh. barge board from the back. See, here's the barge board.
Uh-huh.
It's got these wonderful scallops. But the barge board from the back fell off.
Oh, and it's
but
wedged.
They saved it, wedged
yes,
it in.
Yes, good. That's good.
And Greg, you see these corner posts? See how they're chamfered?
Uh-huh.
It's not just a square post, it's deeper.
Brief. Yeah, it's actually...
On that long axis.
On all of them, that's interesting.
Yeah, all four. The two by the gate post, they're chamfered, but they're square. And we discovered earlier looking around that the gate has been replaced because the pickets on the gate are slightly different.
Yeah, they don't have quite the depth of point
and,
that
and
these
the boards are different. They're a little thicker. And you said your this grandfather was a blacksmith?
Yeah, the one that our grandfather.
Who built this.
Who what the story goes is he built it.
Yeah.
So my question is, when you're almost walking distance away from a marble quarry, why do you have tombstones made out of slate?
Yes.
And you've got examples of early Sylacauga marble stones right there. Yeah. All of those are, well, two on the right are antebellum.
Huh.
So that's very interesting to me. I'd like to know that.
I don't know. I suppose it's possible that the headstones here could be later. I mean, just judging from the way that they are set into.
And someone knew someone who could carve slate.
Yeah.
Because the one.
Peggy, do you know any family history on that?
Because the other slate monuments in Alabama, and I'm sure there are many others, but the other ones I know about are in Mobile. They're from 1819, and they were made in New England because they were northern sailors who died in Mobile, and their families sent them south to mark their graves in Mobile.
Huh.
And that's the kind of material that they used in New England and Massachusetts, and did great, beautiful work, you know, on that.
So, Joey, one of the things, you know, this one, this shelter is set on flat stones.
Right.
On the four corners, like many of them that we see. And then these posts are, it's a south-facing wall. So that's where most of the damage has been. But you can see remnants, the actual tenon.
Right,
here. In there, and that slanted piece of post is actually not supporting anything, but I think that's the old rail, either top or bottom.
Right.
And all the pickets have fallen off, and
you can still see the peg and the tenon down there.
Right. Right.
Well, this is what I want to know about this, because to me, I mean, this is kind of unusual. I can see brick under here, but I can also see rock. And Peggy, do you know why they built this way?
I don't know. When we were younger, they had a different covering over the graves. And as time went by, I know they decayed and fell in.
Uh-huh.
And I assume someone came and I don't know who did it. I know it was my uncle or someone else or another family member came down and did this, cemented and bricked them up.
You know,
but
what
they did have a hole in them.
Oh, okay. Well, you know what this reminds me of is... Sometimes when people mounded graves, they dressed them with a flat top. It's not always, but I've seen that. And I'm wondering if they were after a permanent version of that. Don't know.
Well, it's that vernacular tradition.
Yes,
and having different hands at work, because it was not your grandfather who did this work. You know, with the stonework. I mean, he built the shelter, but a later generation did that. And that is something that I see as well, is that it's more common that there's evidence of repairs and adjustments over the years as families like yours take care of these things. You're real close.
Yeah, thanks.
There you go.
Oh.
And of course, too, for us who have an interest in this, the irony is our attraction and our interest in this has grown over time, but the people who built it or who could give us insight into why did you do it this way or why did you make it this big or whatever that issue is that we're trying to get some historical fact on or some perspective on. Regrettably, we're a day late and a dollar short.
Yeah.
Because the people that could help us, who could have told us exactly why they did it that way. It was so common we never thought to ask, well, why did you do it this way? And now we're intrigued by these, and it's very difficult to get the answers that we would like to have.
Well, this is going to be fabulous when y'all refurbish it.
Yeah.
So, yeah, we're hoping to get started in next year.
Excellent. Well, good. We get to come back and help or see it reborn.
Well, I'm sure we'd more than welcome your help.
Cemetery committees like those at Darien, Eagle Creek, and Blue Springs are preserving the material folk culture of Alabama graveyards. Today, no one is quite sure why our ancestors took the time and expense to build elaborate structures over the in-ground burials of their loved ones. One thing we do know is that without the sacrifice and dedication of these graveyard committees and descendants of those buried there, the Alabama landscape would be missing these well-crafted monuments built with love in a time long ago.